Narona celebrated Holy Mass in the church built by the Brahmar Orthodox community, and hence we get the start of the Brahmar Orthodox mission.
Father Narona, a native of Goa, was also excommunicated from the Roman Catholic Church for his support to the Vajrayana. The teachings of the Orthodox Syrian Church appealed to Father Narona deeply. Father Alvarez and Father Narona struck a deep bond. In May 1889, Father Alvarez hands over charge of Brahmar mission to Father Narona, a true patriot and his trusted colleague, and proceeds to Kerala. Father Antonio Francis Xavier Alvarez was ordained as a full deacon and then later as a priest by His Grace Mar Gregorios Givorgis of Parmala. Father Alvarez was then appointed as the Vicar General of Ceylon. In reverence of his work, Father Alvarez was elevated to Bishop Mar Julius on 29 July 1889 at Old Seminary in Kottayam, Kerala. He was consecrated by the holy bishops Pulikottil Thirumeni, Karavil Thirumeni, Parmala Thirumeni, and Paulos Mar Ivanius Thirumeni, all strongholds of the Orthodox Syrian Church. In those days, the Orthodox practice was limited to Kerala, and the Syriac and Malayalam language was used to celebrate Holy Mass in the church. On being given charge of Ceylon, Goa, and India, excluding Kerala, Bishop Mar Julius was even allowed to conduct the masses as per the Latin rites. The next 5 years were the busiest for Bishop Mar Julius. He crisscrossed the three regions under his charge, helping build and strengthen the faith. On May 27, 1892, Bishop Julius consecrated a French national, Father René Villate, who joined the Orthodox Indian Church. There were several priests of various nationalities who joined the Orthodox Syrian Church. After serving the faith and discharging his duties across the regions, by the end of 1892, Bishop Alvarez Mar Julius returns to Goa. It could be that he had a strong desire to serve his beloved homeland. It was the beginning of the nativity season in Goa, and the people were busy with the Christmas festivities. Meanwhile, Bishop Alvarez had plunged head-on into publishing a new magazine called Obrado Indiano, or The Indian Outcry. The first edition of Obrado Indiano was published on 15 December 1892. It was widely read by the people of Goa. Here was one paper that gave vent to the repressed anger and universal discontent felt by local people towards the Portuguese government. As a true freedom fighter, Bishop Alvarez used the newspaper columns to expose the crooked civil administration of the Portuguese government.
He said, vipers of my country bite and poison the descendants of these conquerors who have put us to shame. He says, long live liberty and independence. So from a certain point of view, they are very politically charged. It's a very politically charged language.
He singled out one of the most corrupt officers of that time, Captain Manuel de Oliveira Gomes da Costa.
It makes it very clear, you know, that it is like a riddle that I am giving you, this man has done this, this and this. Now you tell me who it is. So that the readers would point out to Gomes da Costa. So it was not naming him, but it was writing all the wrong things he did, arbitrary arrest, corruption, all that. And then the last word said, can you tell me who it is? So that's why the title was a riddle. Now this article was considered to be an insulting article. Naturally it was insulting, but it could not be defamation because Father Alvarez had not put any name. Okay, but it was certainly insulting, but not in the nature of sedition. Okay, and you find 3 weeks later on 19th August 1895, that is the first arrest after this article. So this was, these are remote causes, but this could be the immediate cause of the arrest.
Not one to be outdone by a minor religious person, Captain Manuel prepares for battle. He lay in wait for an opportunity to clamp down on Bishop Mar Julius. On 19th August 1895, as Bishop Alvarez was traveling in a horse cart from a nearby village of Santa Cruz, a team of policemen waited for him at the Phoenix Fountain. They attacked the socialist and arrested him right away. They then forcibly stripped him of his episcopal vestments. This was only the beginning of the official reprisal. The humiliation continued, and the officers of the law forced Bishop Julius to remove his religious cross and his ring, both which he steadfastly resisted, saying, "You can do so after me." He was outnumbered, and Bishop was violently overpowered by the policemen who got his religious adornments forcibly removed.
The main reason was this a riddle to be solved. But the reasons given were certain sections of the Portuguese Penal Code. For example, section 130. It said that those who do not respect Roman Catholic religion and do not practice it should be punished. Section 134 said those who pretend to be Roman Catholics should be punished. Section 135 said that being Catholic and denouncing being Catholic, you have to punish this person. Section 235 said those who publicly wage a war against, those who publicly wear gowns and insignias of, like the Syrian Catholic gown, etc., they should be punished. And throughout the case, one must understand that Father Alvarez is referred to as ex-priest. So the Roman Catholic Church does not accept him to a very large extent. The case, of course, is not filed by the church. It is filed by an individual person, the police. And when we say the police, we say the government. But you find by this time there was a kind of a direct confrontation between the Roman Catholic Church and what Father Alvarez believed in.
The officials were not done yet. In utter humiliation, Bishop Alvarez was paraded naked through the streets of Panji.
And very surprisingly, there were about 500 people of Fonda Inish who were following him, cheering him on and jeering Gomes da Costa. Making fun of Gomes da Costa, but praising Father Alvarez.
To add on to the turmoil, Bishop was then confined to a filthy room without chair, table and bed. And the floor smelled of urine and feces. In spite of the sufferings, he spent the whole night in prayer and reverence. The next day, Bishop Mar Julius was presented in the court. With the backing of Captain Manuel, the administration was prepared. The charge leveled against Bishop Alvarez was that of mocking the official dress of a bishop. In those days, only the Portuguese archbishop was authorized to wear prelatic robes. Triumphantly, Bishop Julius produced documentary evidence to the court, proving himself a bishop of the Orthodox Church. Matters turned around. The police came under severe criticism from the court, and the judge released Bishop with all due honor. The embarrassment heaped by the court only added fire to Captain Oliveira's hatred towards Bishop Alvarez. He hatched another plan and got Bishop arrested on 21st August 1895, the very next day of his previous troubles with the law. With the second detention, the law officers now threw the entire weight of the rule book at Bishop Mar Julius. The allegation this time was far more serious: sedition.
He who charges Father Alvarez as being seditious. And the Portuguese word used by him is sedição nativista. That means sedition from a native point, from a native. Okay? Now, from his point of view, the sedition was for certain reasons. And the reasons that were used were inciting the people to fight for liberation, discrediting the Portuguese, insulting government officials. Now, these are hardly any reasons which we would consider to be seditious in nature, but these were the reasons given.
Under such a serious charge, the officials knew that no offender could possibly afford the bail amount. But a prominent lawyer of the court paid the bail amount of rupees 5,000 and got Bishop released.
This case, of course, was considered not to be seditious. Obviously, the reasons cited were not waging a war against the government. It was not violence against the government. That is the actual meaning of sedition, which was not a part of the charges.
The jury cleared Bishop Julius of all allegations of sedition.
In 1895, you have lot of happenings. In August, you have the sedition case. In September, you have the Maratha sepoy mutiny. In October of the same year, you have the Dada Rani revolt. So in the same year, it was a year of uprisings, year of revolts. So certainly, and at that time, this Dada Rani revolt, it was not, all this time the British and the Portuguese were brothers in arms. When I went to the British Library in London and checked the records of the British residents, one of the residents has written a letter that now the Portuguese can look after themselves. Now the British, there's no need to send our soldiers to Goa to defend the Portuguese against the revolts. So by this time, the British had to a very large extent stopped sending their sepoys.
Dada Rani revolt and the mutiny by the sepoys posted to Mozambique in the year 1895 forced the Portuguese to adopt draconian measures of arresting and harassing the suspects. During this time, the press stood banned. With the continuing persecution and a potential threat to his life, Bishop Alvarez had little option but to leave Goa. He travelled 45 miles through the forest of Concon to reach Karwar and then to Brahmawar in Karnataka. He travelled to other parts of South India and Ceylon to continue his missionary work. In October 1910, the Portuguese royal rule in Lisbon was brought to an end and the country became a republic. Along with other Portuguese colonies, Goa also benefited from this change of dynastic rule.
The constitutional monarchy changed to a republic where there was no king. It was a republic. The people elected their government. Now with this there were winds of change where the Hindus, who were for so many centuries treated as second class citizens, were now treated as equal citizens, where people from all religions were given government jobs. There was freedom of religion. People were allowed to practice, preach and propagate their own religion. In the previous centuries, you found people running away from Goa in order to protect their faith, running away with the deities, with their gods. So there was no freedom of religion. But after 1910, there was total freedom of religion.
Meanwhile, Bishop Alvarez continued his spiritual work. He consecrated Father Kanyandra, Father Koshi and others to serve the Brahmavar mission. This period also witnessed rumblings within the Orthodox Church itself. On 8 June 1911, the Patriarch excommunicated Vatisharal Tirmeni. Bishop Julius and many other bishops in turn declared their support to Vatisharal Tirmeni. Bishop Mar Alvarez Julius' sole desire was, "I want to die in my motherland, where I'm hated, among those who don't remember my kindness. My bones too should be here." He eventually left for Goan shores in the year 1912. Though he was 76 years old, yet his urge to serve the poor was still alive and unflinched. For the rest of his life, Bishop Alvarez lived for the poor and the downtrodden, where his house was heaven for the poor. In spite of his deteriorating health, he was often seen on the streets of Panjim with the help of a walking stick collecting alms to serve the poor.
And he started begging, not for his survival, but for the poor. Once a person spit at his begging bowl, and in turn, he said, "That's for me, but give something for the poor." This is a charismatic person who was courageous enough to face challenges of